Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome. Thanks for coming out today. My name is Jason Jay. I'm a graduate student at the MIT Sloan School of Management. Welcome to Come Walk the Talk, which is a really fantastic kickoff event for two things. One is this Energy Futures Week, during which we're going to have a series of events showcasing different aspects of the energy, environment, and sustainability communities here on campus, with a real focus on walking the talk this year on our own campus kind of energy environmental footprint. The other thing is that it's a kickoff for Greening MIT, which you'll hear a lot about today, which is a campaign that we're undertaking to really engage the whole MIT community in working to conserve energy and promote a greener campus. I just want to give a quick thanks to an incredible team of volunteers, students, staff, faculty, administrators who have really worked together to put this week together. You'll hear a lot about the Walk the Talk Task Force that Leanne Glucksman and Terry Stone chair. They've been absolutely critical. The MIT Energy Initiative, Jennifer DeMacy in particular, has been a total star in organizing this week. So I hope you have a great time. I hope you enjoy the presentations. And without further ado, I'm going to introduce Bob Armstrong. He's one of the co-chairs of the MIT Energy Initiative. Bob is going to be talking about the progress of the Energy Initiative as a whole. And after that, we're going to hear from Terry Stone, the Executive Vice President, from Steve Lanou from the Environmental Programs Office, and I'll have a few words to say as well. Welcome, and Bob Armstrong, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here this afternoon and give you a little bit of an update on where the Energy Initiative stands. We started, or at least the idea of a focus at MIT on energy started with Susan Hockfield's inauguration. In her speech in 2005, she highlighted energy and associated environmental concerns as a great responsibility, big opportunity for a place like MIT. To focus its considerable talents and creativity and effort in the coming years. And so as a result of that charge, we formed an Energy Research Council, which spent a year or so trying to frame the problem and suggest some ways MIT should go about this. About 2 years ago, as a result of that, Susan formed the MIT Energy Initiative, or MITEI. So we've been in existence now for about 2 years, and I think we've made a lot of progress over this first two-year period. In this first 2 years, we focused initially on trying to bring research sponsors, industrial government partners together with us to get a set of funded programs in place that we could use to engage faculty, students, and staff broadly across the Institute. Yeah, we have now some 30 industrial and government partners sponsoring research and other activities somewhere around $220 million. That's the initial five-year commitment from these sponsors. As part of the program of sponsorship, our industry partners commit part of their funding to an energy seed research fund. We solicit broadly from the faculty twice a year early stage seed ideas for research. And we've done two rounds of those so far. We've just received proposals in a third round. In the first two rounds, we got something like 100 plus proposals, 31 of which we funded for a total of about $3.9 million in those first two rounds. We have a Society of Energy Fellows, again funded by the industrial sponsors with part of their membership fees. There are 39 graduate fellows at MIT in this first year as a result of those energy fellowships. And we're very excited about the kind of students that allows us to attract to MIT. Novel ideas in energy curriculum underway. I'll say a little bit more about that in a minute. As well as other things. The Energy Initiative, as we put it together, is built around four components. The first of those is research, engaging the campus broadly in energy-related research. Education, obviously very important for a place like MIT. campus energy management, which is the focus of today's session, and outreach or service by MIT as an honest broker in the public discussion about energy and energy policy. I mentioned our partners. We have some 30 partners now in several categories. The two categories that are primarily responsible for funding research are what we call founding and sustaining members. And we have both corporate and public categories there. We created a public category because we had some governmental entities that wanted to join. Founding members support us at a rate of $5 million per year and up, and sustaining members at $1 million per year and up. We also have associate and affiliate members who also bring to the table other parts of the energy spectrum. The sponsor research portfolio that has come together with those sponsors in this first 2 years is quite broad. We put it into four major categories. We have a category we call innovation, making today's energy systems as efficient and as environmentally responsible as we can. And that's critical because of the long time scales and the large inertia in today's energy system. We're going to be dependent on these energy systems 20, 30 years plus into the future, and so it's important we learn how to live with those responsibly. And I list some of the examples of programs there. Major coal conversion program is one of the examples. A second category is what I would call transformations of today's energy systems. Looking at the key breakthroughs in technology that will enable future advances towards sustainable energy going forward. There we have large and diverse programs in solar energy, in bioscience, energy bioscience, developing programs in geothermal and other renewable resources. So broad range of programs there. Third category is global energy systems. It's not an orthogonal mapping with the others, but it's a grouping that emphasizes the cross-cutting global character of some of what we do. Climate change is a prime example there. And then lastly, programs looking at what I would call basic tools. Very fundamental science that's perhaps not yet tied to a specific energy application, but that will be critical for the energy breakthroughs of the future. Multi-electron chemistry, important for catalysis, is one I would cite there. In addition to research, two key programmatic themes in the energy initiative are education and campus energy management. You'll hear more about the education in other venues. I'll just say one of the things we're very excited about is an undergraduate energy minor, which the Education Task Force has put together and is going through institute approval right now. It's just passed through COC, and we hope that it will be in place for next fall. A minor that every undergraduate at MIT could take advantage of, independent of his or her major. And then, of course, walk the talk, an opportunity to couple what we do in research, what we do in education, how we can involve undergraduates, staff, faculty, together with the administration to do the best we can in using this campus as a living laboratory to try out new ideas and also to show our commitment and how to model energy efficiency in physical plant. And lastly, outreach activities. A role that we have been asked over and over again by our stakeholders is to get involved in the public debate and to play a role as an honest broker in the discussion. And I think we've done a very good job in the past at that as an institution. Some examples of activity undergoing, we have underway now, include a series of studies looking at different energy technologies that can help us globally meet projected energy demands in the future in a carbon-constrained world. There's been a study completed on nuclear power, one on coal, and there are three new studies underway on solar energy and natural gas and an advanced fuel cycle study in nuclear power. So that's a quick run-by of the energy initiative. A lot happened in 2 years. It's a fast-moving area. One of the most gratifying parts of this initiative has been the campus involvement, though. We now have some 200 faculty on campus engaged in one way or another with the energy initiative. That's right at 20% of the faculty. So we are delighted for that, and we look forward to working with all of you on this. Thank you.
We're going to do a longer Q&A session at the end where people can pose questions and we can have a conversation all together with all of the presenters. The next person I'd like to introduce is Theresa Stone, who is our Executive Vice President. She is the executive of MIT, who's in charge of a lot of the way things run around here, from facilities to security to environmental health and safety, and all those sorts of departments that have a real direct bearing on our impact as a campus. Terry, she's also the co-chair of the Walk the Talk Task Force, and she has a few words to say as well. Thank you, Terry.
Hello. They've mic'd me up and they told me they would.
There we go.
Lift off.
My voice goes up and down, so if you can't hear me, just stick up your hand and remind me that you can't hear me. So anyway, I'm delighted to be here. As Jason and Bob described, I'm here primarily in my role as co-chair of the Campus Energy Task Force. And this has been really one of the most interesting things for me. I've only been back at MIT doing what I'm doing for a couple of years. I went to the Sloan School and was on the board and stuff like that for a number of years, but only back in this role. And I do have responsibility more or less for the physical space around MIT and many, many different aspects of it. And one of the earliest things I got involved with was working with Leon Glucksman as co-chairs of this energy task force, which was already starting to really get going a couple of years ago. But I do think there's just been huge development and evolution and progress in what we're doing. Probably the most impressive thing about it is that it is really a collaboration across all types of people here at the Institute. And I think that's not only impressive, but it's the reason why we are succeeding and why we need your help, because we really can succeed if we have this kind of involvement. So this meeting, the meetings that are coming up over the rest of the program this week, are really to try to get the message across that every one of you can help us to make a huge difference in what we're doing. And I think that's because we have such good collaboration that we've gotten really good pilot projects started. We've proved that we can really move the dial in very doable specific areas that we have identified. We've tried these things out. We've got proof, we've got measurement. And what we need now is to really, really get this completely widely dispersed across the campus. And I think the important thing that we have now is this year is really the year of bringing together as broadly a disseminated behavioral aspect to some of these projects that we have designed and tested out on a pilot phase. So just to give you a couple of examples, I think many of you have heard these examples before, but just to give a little bit of a flavor, one of the things that was focused on was the fact that probably our biggest energy hogs here on campus, would not surprise you, have to do with the research enterprise. Now, we are preeminently a research institution, so we're not going to stop doing research to save energy. But importantly, are there ways in which we conduct this research that could be more energy efficient? And so the fume hoods project, which was one of the things that'll please shut your sash is going to try to amplify, was the pilot program that we did with the Department of Chemistry. Because it turns out that the behavior that one has with respect to putting up and putting down the fume hood on the many, many, I think it's 800 fume hoods around campus, is really one of the most clear and simple things that we can do if we get people educated. Importantly, the Department of Chemistry has been a great partner with the facilities folks in focusing on this, and with the task force in focusing on this. And so there's really been great behavior awareness and change in the Department of Chemistry. But that's just a fraction, I don't know, maybe 15 or so percent of the fume hoods on campus. So part of what we want to do this year is to get this program, which is really quite effective in awareness and a little bit of social pressure, let's say, because there are reports. Your fume hood had such and such a position, and it was not as well positioned as so many of your peers here in the chemistry department. And as a result, you know, we could have heated so many houses, you know, in the Boston area on what you lost, but your colleague didn't. So that kind of thing, which is sort of gentle persuasion. But I think people around here really believe in conserving energy. They want MIT to do the right thing. And so most folks are really quite open and receptive once they get their attention focused on it. So these kinds of things, we know they work. We know they're very doable. And the question is, how can we get the whole campus behaving in a way that reflects what we know about all of this? And we have a variety of ways that we're going to go about this. Again, all of these kind of thought about at the Energy Task Force, but with anybody else who wants to talk about it, because the main thing here is to be very inclusive in who's involved with it. So part of what Jason's going to talk about is really trying to get the sort of foot soldiers from the community at large, just as we did in the whole recycling campaign some years ago, where people were really out there with the awareness and kind of pretty much integrated into the whole campus on this kind of thing. Importantly, the Environmental Health and Safety Department here at MIT is known as really the partner of people in the labs about having safety in the labs, proper procedures in the labs. So they're the trusted partner, I think, of the labs across campus. And they are very fired up about this. Since they're out, you know, on a professional basis, working with the labs on safety, that they can be out there talking to people who are there and really being the representatives, I call them a little bit the foot soldiers, to bring the message out about the behaviors that we're hoping to have out there. At the same time, I think we're going to try and get a whole volunteer corps who will participate with that and get the work of that particular program done. So that's really just an example. There are many, many more having to do with the dorms, having to do with IS&T behavior. I think importantly, we have also, over the last year, begun to have some focus with in the professional areas around the facilities and administrative areas of MIT. So you'll be hearing from Steve Lanou. Steve, you know, is in environmental health and safety, but he does a huge amount of work with student groups, with community groups, trying to help to facilitate and to make sure that we're getting the kind of involvement there. So we've got, you know, a dedicated professional in environmental health and safety. Dick Amster has just been able to identify Megan Gafaris in his area, who's one of the project managers, who will be helping us to really use a project management bent when we're trying to do some of the retrofits that we're doing around campus that will also help us sort of the more physical, technical, construction kinds of things we need to do. She'll be the point person on making sure that we're getting those things done. Deb Leach will be working with her to make sure that we have got the measurement techniques as clear and as defensible as they can be, because there's a lot of talk about saving energy, but this is MIT. We really have to be extremely responsible and disciplined about the kind of measurement that we put behind these things and show them. And I think on that front, you know, we've been well, just mention one last person, Lakshmi Rao in the IS&T department has been a special purpose assignment for her, has been to help us with a lot of the IS&T related things. One of the things here, power it down, Lakshmi's been helping us all to understand the way we behave with our computers, our personal computers, our laptops, et cetera, different ways in which, you know, we can save energy on those devices. But we've been very fortunate. When I arrived a couple of years ago, there was already a project that was well underway that was a collaborative project with the Sloan School, some graduate students in the S Lab and the Facilities Department, where there had been a request, and again, many of you have heard about this, but I'll just reemphasize this as kind of embodiment. There was a request to try to find, have facilities churn up some ideas about things that if we did this or this, we could save energy. And the charge to them from my predecessor was find things that really have good return on investment. Because, you know, these things won't be sustainable from an economic standpoint if we don't not only save energy, but save money. And so the S-Lab helped the facilities folks to put into a very rigorous return on investment kind of methodology a whole series of retrofits and other projects that we could do with the help of Peter Cooper and Walt Henry, again, two of our key professionals in this area in the facilities side. And we came up with a portfolio of $14 million worth of things that if we put the money in within 2 or 3 years, we'd actually be saving that amount of money in investment in energy costs. And I seeded that with the $500,000 from the discretionary money that I had available, which at that time, that was 1/3 of my discretionary money. Next year, I don't have that discretionary money because we're all in budget times. But that was a lot of, that was a big percentage of what I had available. And we got those projects done. The returns are coming in right now. And interestingly enough, some of you may be alum here in the audience. When I go out to talk in my role as chief financial officer about how we're doing, alums always want to know how we're doing financially, which they should want to know. And I talk to them about that. And then they say, well, that's all very interesting, but what are you doing about energy on campus? And so in a lot of these sort of casual conversations, people have, and I say, well, we're just doing kind of nitty-gritty stuff. We're getting the fume hoods fixed. We're getting the light bulbs changed. You know, we're doing stuff that you might view as pretty pedestrian. They say, no, that's really what it's all about. When you have 11 million square feet of space, it's not about something kind of sexy and exciting and kind of the new solar panel. It's all about how you retrofit the so-called built environment that was built in some cases 100 years ago and to have it be energy efficient. And some of these alums were really on the verge now of, because they just responded to this, you know, of giving us some significant dollars to help us to do these investments because they're really persuaded by the importance of it and by the fact that, you know, if we do these investments and we get those things fixed, we can get some more money into it. So, you know, as I say, we're getting some pretty significant volunteer interest from the alums to give us some money to move these things forward, which I think is really pretty amazing. So, an important part, of course, of all of this is we are in new construction around campus. And you all know that we're putting up a cancer center, we're putting up the media lab, we put up NW35. And importantly, I think one of the good things about the task force was that as these buildings were coming into their final design phases, but pre-construction, we were able to get extremely good input from Leon Glicksman, from Les Norford, from others in the building technology group on the faculty, so that we really did focus and push very hard on things like what should the fume hoods be in the new buildings, what should the hot water system be in the new dorm. And as a result, I think you're going to have some buildings that we can be very proud of here on campus because the focus was brought, again, by this collaboration of the faculty and the facilities and the students here on campus. So that's just a little bit of a flavor of it. We need all of you. We're recruiting. We need people to really be involved. Things are working. We've got some very concrete stuff that can make a difference, and we hope that you'll all get involved in some of the activities that are going to be described to you over the coming days.
Thank you, Terry. The next person I'd like to introduce is Steve Lanou. Steve is the Deputy Director of Environmental Sustainability here at MIT. I'm just going to get his slides up. He's been an absolutely incredible ally for students who want to get involved in campus energy issues, and has really served as an important bridge between a lot of different constituencies here at MIT. He's very knowledgeable about sort of both the technical aspects of this and what we're trying to do in terms of transforming MIT as an organization, as a community of people. Steve, welcome. I'm very excited to hear your talk.
Thank you, Jason. Thank you, Terry, and thank you, Bob. And I really am only as good as the partners I'm working with here in our Department of Facilities and Transportation and all over campus. So what a great turnout. I'm thrilled to see so many people come out. I remember this a similar event last year we had to introduce people to the Energy Initiative and some of our activities. It was following 2 feet of snow. And we still had a good turnout, and so today's even better. So I look forward to working with a lot of you following this about questions and taking some of what you're hearing today back to your place here at MIT. And my goal right now really is to shed a little bit of light on what are we talking about, MIT's energy footprint, MIT's carbon footprint, and reducing that footprint. What does it mean here? We've heard a lot of the activities that we're doing. But I'm trying to help to put some of that into perspective and offer up some of the activities that we're doing and invite you all to help us shape some of our activities going forward. So first, our energy footprint really starts with all of the energy that we're using here on campus as over $1 billion operation. And to run our research and education enterprise takes a lot of energy. To the tune of about $60 million a year, just in the purchase of the fuel we need to power our campus. And so it's interesting to see how much energy we use and see that part of that challenge is a rising energy use. And as we know about the volatility of the costs of fuel, is a challenge to us. And you'll see sort of where our energy goes. It's in our electricity. It's in our steam for heating, it's in our chilled water for keeping us cool in the summer, and for our water and basic sewers. And again, this is a focus on the building energy use, and we know there are other sources of energy around transportation. But this right here, we're going to focus on some of the utility energy, because that's really what we're going to focus on trying to bring down through engaging all of us. So how does that translate? So I see our energy challenge is the greenhouse gas emissions associated with that energy use is one of our challenges. We talked a little bit about the financial challenge of escalating energy costs and use, but its impact relative to climate change. And so this is one of my favorite graphs. It is based on a master's thesis done several years ago, which was the first attempt at taking an inventory of all the sources of our greenhouse gas emissions. And so this chart shows you up through 2006, essentially what our calculated greenhouse gas emissions are. And then as part of a planning exercise we started a couple years ago is to think about what is our energy use and therefore our greenhouse gas emissions going to look like going forward through 2020. And this is, to the best of our knowledge, what it's going to look like. And it offers a good opportunity to sort of understand where it's coming from, why it's there, and what do we want to look like going forward. And it also told an interesting story about the past. We first put this together, and I had a question about how can we be predicting future energy use and greenhouse gas emissions to be rising where our past doesn't bear that out. We looked into it, and our friends in facilities dug around and tried to answer that question. And in fact, in the early 90s, we were doing quite a bit of investment in energy conservation. So we see in the early years of the 1990s a flat energy use. And in fact, Building 68 came online at that time without any net increase in energy use. And so that's an interesting story. And then you see this dip in 1995, which was when our cogeneration facility came online and essentially made the power that we produce, we produced it much more efficiently with different fuels. But it also gives you the opportunity to see that, in fact, going forward, we expect increasing energy use through new space additions, but also just from more things in offices, more things in labs. We're seeing plug loads, the stuff that gets plugged into labs and offices growing at a regular rate. And so that's an issue to deal with. So It also offers an interesting opportunity to look at, well, if we wanted to look at how can we reduce our greenhouse gas emissions in a sort of coordinated and strategic way, say looking back to a popular protocol of 1990 levels, well, how would we get there? And we started to look around and try to find out some of the big items that we can do. And one of them was focusing on expanding the cogeneration facilities that we have here would have a significant impact to the tune of about reducing about 53,000 tons of greenhouse gas emissions a year. The next slice, essentially, is what would be saved through building all of our new buildings to a high degree of high-performance buildings. And interestingly, one of the largest chunks is about energy conservation. Essentially, it's said that the U.S. is sort of the Saudi Arabia of energy conservation. And so that really was borne out here in the analysis, is that a big chunk of our reduction is going to come from energy conservation on campus. And at the end of the day, despite doing all the hard work you can do on campus, you're still going to have to look elsewhere in terms of renewable power. But that we'll save that discussion for another day. So I want to focus on the energy conservation slice of that. There are a number of activities that can happen, and largely I'm dividing it into these engineered solutions, the things that can be done that are being done that you don't necessarily see. The things that not all of us are participating in. Many of those folks who are participating are here, but many of us aren't. They have to do with fixing our lighting retrofits that Terry discussed. We've got evidence of its effectiveness. Continuous commissioning is looking at the buildings that we have and monitoring them to see if they're operating optimally. If they're not, where and how can we fix it? We've got some good experience over in Building 18 in the Z Center, which by just understanding how the buildings are operating and flagging systems that aren't working correctly, going to fix those. $500,000 a year savings, which can accrue to fixing those. Steam trap renewals, fixing those little devices on your radiators that are failing. Across campus, we can have saved $800,000 a year, which is about a year and a half payback, I believe, for those activities. So using new technologies and some of our renovations, such as chilled beams in the main group, which is addressing how are we going to meet some of the air conditioning needs in a more efficient way. Then there's green buildings. Terry mentioned our green building programs, which have demonstrated nationally that green buildings are performing about 25% better than the existing stock. And so there are a lot of things that you don't see that will have to continue, will have to be deepened. As Terry said, these pilot programs need to be expanded. And looking also at some of the engineered ways about how can we finance some of these activities. And Terry mentioned some of the interest in funding these activities. And we're also beginning a pilot program which is looking to take some of those investments that we're making and take some of those savings from those investments and pour them back into additional energy conservation to provide some mechanism to address the challenges of funding some of these activities. So that all said, there's also the community solution, and that's why we're all here today. There's the engineered activities that have to happen, but there's also the community, engaging the community broadly in driving some of the progress. And so that's all of us. We can all do something in our own place, whether it's our lab, our office, our dormitory. And it's about the personal decisions that we can make, the choices that we make, and the individual actions that may not seem like a lot individually, but altogether, collectively, and I'll show you a few examples, actually can make a difference. So that's the gist of what we're looking at today, is introducing a few of the some high-profile but simple activities that all of us can do, and we make choices about them every day, and collectively we can make a difference. Lighting. It bothers a lot of us to no end walking around campus and seeing lights on when nobody's in them. We have evidence now that a lot of spaces that are lit aren't occupied 30 or 55% of the time. That was thanks to a terrific Europe activity that was done this summer. So, turning off the lights, one of them. Terry mentioned powering it down. And Lakshmi Rao and IS&T has really been helpful in developing not only guidelines, but helping us understand what's the impact of our 20,000 computers on campus. And what if all of us decided to use the power management features, put it to sleep, hibernate it, put it to bed when you go home? $800,000, essentially, if all of us took advantage of these power-saving features on our computers. It's big stuff. Terry mentioned shut the sash, over 1,000 fume hoods. And a pilot program has shown that with some feedback, awareness, education on what is the energy that's used in these fume hoods, gets people to act. In fact, with rolling out this program widely around variable air volume fume hoods, getting people to shut their sashes, and really take advantage of the engineered solutions that are available for energy conservation can make a real difference. So, what else? An interesting one, while it may not be the highest impact of all the things that are available to us, it's high impact visibility. It's using the revolving doors. They're there for a design. We had a terrific class team and then some individuals following up afterwards on sort of getting an idea of what is the impact of using revolving doors. It's pretty interesting. You know, you waste essentially 8 times as much air by using a fixed door than a revolving door. And in the building, in E25 alone, which I think all of us go through at least twice a day, if everybody who was going through those doors used the revolving doors, essentially it'd save as much heat to heat 5 houses in the U.S. That's quite a lot. And we have 27 more revolving doors around campus. So it's there. And so a lot of these things having to do with just us being aware of what the impacts are and what the choices, what can I do differently? So it's about stopping and thinking, what can I do a bit differently to conserve energy? And these are just some of them, and what we've tried to do is pull out some of the ones that we feel have some of the highest impact that all of us can do as individuals. And this has to be paired with those engineered solutions that we talked about. And it's not any one group's responsibility in terms of, it's not only our facilities groups, it's not only our EHS responsible for getting some of these things done in the engineered things and the things that you don't see, but it's all of us individually to take some steps. And so I encourage you to visit the MITEI campus website, where we've got some new tools and tips in order for you guys to take some of this and start making a difference in your own place. So I'm just going to go through quickly on this, and I don't want to take away any of Jason's thunder, but it's really about how can we get all of us engaged. It's about creating and strengthening this community of individuals who are interested in driving and acting in change, driving change here on campus. We're going to do a Green Ambassadors program for those who want to sign up and either just in their own way take information and back to their office and encourage different practices, or be explicit about it and join a group of people who will share experiences and also get information back. Tell us about your expertise. We clearly don't have all the answers. You all know what's best, what are the best practices, what's actually going on in your lab, in your place. Share those with us, and so we can share them with others. Wednesday, we have a workshop called Greening Your Place. Come join us on Wednesday and learn some more. And what you're also seeing here is the introduction of the Greening MIT logo. Who saw it before they came in this room today? That's pretty good. It just came out essentially this weekend. Many thanks to Melody Craven, our Department of Facilities, who did yeoman's duty in listening to all of us with what we wanted to do about creating an identity to strengthen and reinforce this sort of this community of practice. We want to have a visual representation of what we're all doing. We want people to see this and know that other people are doing their part. So keep your eyes open for this around campus, either on signs, on communications, and really it's just a reminder that we collectively, as an institution, are taking steps in the right direction. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Jason Jay, who is going to share with us some more tips and strategies about how we're looking at engaging all of you. So thank you.
Okay, I apologize for my voice. I think this mic should actually help me a little bit. I can't tell you guys how excited I am to see this turnout today. This is something that we've been working on for a long time to try to get a behavior change campaign and a community engagement campaign launched. And this number of people showing up is really lets me know that that this is really possible, and that there's a lot of interest and a lot of people who want to come join in this effort. when I was an undergraduate, a little bit up the river, I don't think I would have made it to an event like this. I was, during the week, very focused on grades and getting them on my transcript. On the weekends, very focused on having a good time, which usually meant coming down to MIT because it was a lot more fun than up the river. I wasn't someone who was very sort of conscious or engaged or involved in these sorts of things. A couple of years after I graduated, I went on a trip around the world and just to do a little bit of adventuring and reflecting. And I was up in northern India in the foothills of the Himalayas, and I was just out on a walk, and I came across this 15-meter-long dry riverbed that was about a meter deep in plastic water bottles and foil and plastic wrappers and other sort of refuse from these consumer products that were really starting to arrive at that time, many of whom had been discarded by tourists just like me, international tourists, Indian tourists, and folks in the area. And I started to realize, wow, this is going to be a problem. And if the almost a billion people in India start consuming at this level, we're going to have some pretty serious issues. But when I came back to the States, it was sort of, I sort of realized that the problem's bigger than this, because we don't have those ditches lying around. We throw things in the trash and they disappear, they go away. We turn on the lights, we turn on our computers and our iPhones, and the power turns on, and most of us don't really have any sense of where that comes from. Few of us ever visit a power plant, unless we're fortunate enough to take a tour of the cogen facility here at MIT. So I started to think, well, okay, this is actually going to take a change in the way that we think and the way that we act in our habits. A few years later, I came to MIT to work on exactly those kinds of questions. I came to MIT Sloan, you know, with this aspiration to work on change and to think about how can individuals and organizations and industries move towards more sustainable habits and practices. But very quickly, when I arrived on campus, it was a realization, well, actually, we've got a lot to do here. Some of the things that Steve has pointed out. I'd walk around at night and see whole buildings lit up with nobody inside. I started talking to friends in labs who let me know about this whole fume hood concept, one fume hood being equivalent in energy use to a single family home, and we've got over 1,000 of them. So I started to get inspired, as many of us have, by this idea that our campus could be a learning laboratory, a place where we are a beacon for other institutions and where we can experiment with new techniques on campus, both technical and in terms of engaging our community, that could be examples for other places. I started to get involved in these activities, and a few of us got involved in something called the MIT Generator. I joined this Walk the Talk task force that we've been hearing about, and was really inspired very quickly by the fact that we've really started to get a community of people who are fascinated and passionate and engaged in these issues of energy, environment, and sustainability. But as I continued through this kind of work, I realized very quickly that this is the start, and now we're going to need to do something much bigger. We're actually going to have to engage the entire MIT community. This can't just be about a community of people who are really amped about energy, environment, sustainability. Because this isn't about the campus energy use. This is about my office. It's about your office. It's about your lab. It's about your dorm room. It's about this classroom and all the other classrooms and labs and dormitories and offices that we all live in every day. It's about trying to take more responsibility for our place at MIT. And that's something that Steve said earlier. It's a theme sort of this week, is that we all have some place on the MIT campus that's ours, whether it's our dorm or our office or our lab or our classrooms or other parts of the physical plan. And we can all sort of start to look at, well, okay, what are the habits that we're together acting out that are affecting energy use on campus? The tricky thing is, if we wanted to kick these habits, if we want to change, it's not actually trivial, right? Changing habits is hard. New Year's Eve was just a couple weeks ago. We've probably all made some resolutions. I've already started breaking mine. I think we probably all are having that experience. And it's even harder when the habits are collective. So we've heard a little bit about revolving doors, right? So how many of you have walked up to a building where there's a revolving door and a swing door, right? Somebody goes through the swing door, and what do? They prop the door open for the next person. So the next person who comes goes through the swing door, and the next person comes through the swing door. And pretty soon you have a line of people who are all going through the swing door. The door is open, the heat's escaping out into the January cold. So it's not just about our individual behaviors. It is. And it is about leading the way. Because if I, as the first person arriving at that building, walk through the revolving door, and I get it going, everyone's going to follow me. Right? Well, this is my experience. Maybe you disagree. But this is part of why we have to start a conversation at the level of the institute. So the question is, well, how do we shift collective habits? That seems hard, right? There's some research on this kind of thing. There's a lot of people who have run a lot of campaigns on these sorts of things. I have sort of a way that I've started thinking about it, which is based a little bit on something called community-based social marketing. It's a little bit based on the expertise and kind of built wisdom of the Working Group on Recycling, which has made a lot of progress already here on campus, and just sort of based on our reflections in the task force and other places about MIT. And it's sort of these five elements. One is that we can change policies. There's a few ways in which we're officially wasting energy. So until recently, janitors, when they come to an office, their policy was leave the office as you found, leave the lights as you found them, so you don't piss anybody off. That's a policy that's easy to change and that we're in the process of changing, so that the default is, no, you turn off the lights when you find them on, unless there's a really good reason not to. So there is some amount of sort of policy change and some amount of the investing in the built infrastructure, which is a lot of what we heard from Terry and Steve. A second thing that we can do is that we can change the physical environment to make doing the right thing easier and more obvious. So we can put up signs like this that say flip the switch, even you know right next to a light switch so that you're reminded to turn off the lights. We can put the recycling bins where people actually need them and where people are going to use them. So we can change the physical environment to encourage people to do the right thing. We can change people's minds. We can educate them. We can let them know the facts. Fume hood, equivalent to a single family home. But turns out that some of the most important facts are about what other people are doing. So if I were to put up a sign in my office in E52, or in a common area that said 90% of the people on this floor turn off their lights when they're not in their offices, help us save energy by turning off your light. Turns out that's the most effective wording, because people look to others to know what the right thing is to do. Hence, that's a little bit part of the sort of following each other through the swing door. So we can start to educate each other, but this also gets to this idea of norms. We have to shift the sort of tacit rules that are having us do what we do. A good example of this is I recently heard about a lab where there's sort of an unspoken rule that at night you actually do leave the lights on in your lab so that when people walk by the building, they know that that lab is really hardcore. Right? So in a sense, this makes sense. Like, this is, you know, we're a competitive campus, we're a pioneering campus, we're really trying to sort of race our way towards new discoveries in science and technology. But it doesn't make as much sense when we're starting to really be conscious of, well, what are the costs, short term, long term? What are the fossil fuels that we're extracting? What are the greenhouse gases that we're emitting? So we have to start sort of encouraging new norms. And it's very simple. It's a very simple process. It looks like having a conversation. It looks like talking to your office mate. Hey, when I leave the room, I'm just going to turn off the light. If you come back, it doesn't mean I'm gone. It just means that, you know, I'm trying to save energy. If I see your monitor on, is it okay if I just turn it off when I know that you're not going to be here? You know, those kinds of conversations very quickly start to shift the rules by which we all operate. And then the last thing is, it's really useful to give people feedback. People can change their own behavior if they kind of know how they're doing. So if we can give people feedback about, this is how your dorm is doing, this is how your lab is doing, and this becomes really fun when you do it in the form of a competition. We've seen as much as 30% reduction in energy use during the dorm electricity competition, which has been going the last couple of years. And we can do a lot more of that. We can get labs competing, offices, departments. We can even have our whole campus competing against Harvard or other schools. So the question is, so this is great. This is sort of a nice theoretical framework. The question is, who's doing this? Who's doing the work here? Well, the first answer is all of us. We all have some role to play. We all can put up a sign. We all can talk to our peers, have these conversations. That's one answer which I think is absolutely critical, because it really is going to take all of us doing our part. A second answer is that we do have a Walk the Talk task force. And there are things that that task force can do to serve as kind of a focal point or a center of activity around these issues. Some of the people on the task force actually have the power to make these policy changes. We can help develop, you know, branding and messaging like this greening MIT logo. We can do community organizing by holding events like this where we try to get people involved. We can try to set new norms at the level of the institute. So we've come up with something called the MIT Energy Commitment, which just simply says MIT is committed to inventing, developing, teaching, and practicing sustainable energy generation and use. It's a simple commitment, it's a simple statement, it's a simple kind of norm at the institute level, but then, of course, we all have to figure out what that means to us. What does that mean in my place at MIT? And then, of course, the measurement and feedback is something that's going to require some infrastructure. We do have to do some metering and things. So there's something that we can all do, there's something that the task force can do, but the critical thing this week, and the critical thing now, is that there's sort of a middle layer in between the two, where how are we going to get from the people who are in that task force room or the people who are in this room to everybody on campus? And the idea there is, well, maybe we could have some kind of like, you know, organizer thing or like a green ambassador thing. And this is something that's starting to pick up a lot of energy and a lot of interest. What is a green ambassador? It's very simple. It's not a really formal or very official commitment. It just says, I will do my best to green my place, to change the habits in my area of MIT. You know, I can help implement policy changes. I can suggest policy changes up the line. I can put up the prompts and tools. I can engage in peer learning. I might give presentations to people in my lab about fume hoods and what we can do to make a difference. I can engage in these conversations. I can share some of the feedback and organize competitions. And this is really what we want to see happen this week and sort of over the next couple of months, is that we really galvanize a network of these ambassadors. This is something that we've seen the Working Group on Recycling be really successful with. Like Terry said, the Environmental Health and Safety Coordinators are sort of a natural backbone for this. The Undergraduate Association's Sustainability Committee has already started developing sustainability representatives in the laboratories. So we can start to build these networks, we can start to have people on the ground who are really engaging the community in this kind of conversation. And as we all kind of saw, whatever your politics, we all saw what the Obama campaign was capable of through this kind of organizing. And a lot of us learned that it doesn't actually take that much to pick up the phone or to knock on a door or to stand by the polls. It doesn't take that much to put up a sign or talk to people on your floor or drop an email saying, hey, you know, these are some resources that we could use that would make a big difference in being able to conserve energy in our part of MIT. So this is the invitation today. This is the invitation this week. There's a sign-up sheet outside the door where, you know, there is the option to give your email address if you're interested in being an ambassador. For now, all this means is being signed up on an email list, and gradually that will evolve over time as the ambassadors themselves give some tips about what this might look like. Now, of course, Energy Futures Week is a great opportunity to kind of get this going. I think, you know, there's a few different events that are happening. Probably the key one for what I've been talking about is on Wednesday there's a Sustainability in Action workshop, which Steve mentioned, which is sort of a training session for ambassadors where you can get tools and learn resources and maybe become a green ambassador. Could someone get that? Thanks. And maybe become a green ambassador, maybe join in some of this activity, and okay. Looks like we have a guest. Tim, yeah, right. Tim, can I help you, Tim? You want me to just keep going? Okay. So we've got this workshop on Wednesday, which is a great way to come become an ambassador. There's a lot of other ways to just get yourself informed about climate policy, about energy efficiency technologies, about careers in energy, and you can even sort of get your hands dirty in learning about this infrastructure aspect by joining with Peter Cooper and going and doing a lighting audit of the DuPont Center. And looking at what might be involved in transforming the physical infrastructure along with some of these behavior changes. The last thing is a student group and project showcase, which which is a chance to learn about what some student groups are doing and getting engaged in this. There's been a really powerful role for students who have been, there's a group called Closing the Loop that has been a particular kind of galvanizing force in thinking about community and engagement and behavior change. There'll be a way to kind of get a sense of what's happening on the cutting edge of those sorts of efforts. So we hope you sign up to be an ambassador if you can. We hope that you engage in this conversation with us. And Tim, you have a question? You want to come down here? You have some idea of how to help? Okay, come on down. Stairs. You want a hand? Thanks for coming by, Tim. Awesome. So what, Tim? How can we help you? What's going on? You're bored by my presentation. That's great. Thanks. I suppose you think you might be able to do better. Yeah. All right. Should we give Tim a chance?
Let's get it started. and
what do you think of that? Very nice, very nice. There's more? You've got more. You want to give the slides to everybody? Excellent, excellent. So this slideshow is exactly the kind of example of tools and resources that we want to make available to ambassadors. This will be anyone who wants to come sign up. Again, come to the Wednesday workshop. Get a presentation like this. Beaver costume's optional. And give a talk in your dorm. Give a talk in your lab, in your office, in your place at MIT, and help us make a difference. Okay? Tim, thanks for your help. Have a good one. Take the revolving door. So now we'll open the floor for questions. As I said in the beginning, questions for Bob, for Terry, for Steve, for myself. We're interested in getting input on this. Again, this is all very provisional. This is going to be an iterative process as we figure out how to engage people, how to get this going, how to get it started, as Tim said. So let's open it up. If you have questions for me, you can ask, and if you address them to others, then we can be done. Go ahead.
Who are our models? Who's ahead of us? Who can we learn from? Institutions, countries, cultures? Are we the blazing trail, or are there those from whom we're going to look trying to learn?
It's both. MIT's unique sort of angles on this, I think, is this issue of measurement and verification. There are a lot of statements made around the country, around the world, about what can be done and what can't be done. And so I think one of the things that we're looking to do is develop some of these pilot programs and actually show that they work and where they don't work, and have some quantifiable evidence and argument behind it. MIT was one of the first schools to adopt a green building policy in the early 2000s, and that was an early leader step in that capacity. So it's a little of both. Particularly the way we've engaged students has been well received. And I'll often talk about our energy footprint and what we're doing on campus. And I'll mention a little bit about what we're doing with students. And 9 times out of 10, the questions come back about how are you engaging your students so well, so deeply, so often. And there's a lot of interest in how we're getting our students to help both us understand what our challenges are, but what are some of our solutions. And so I think that's a pretty unique MIT spin.
What's on my mind is that, and I'm operating from a place of ignorance myself and apathy, but one of the things on my mind is that there's countries where they're 50, just light years ahead of us with sustainability and recycling. And so they're picking up trash once a month, and they're recycling, they're picking up recycling twice a week. And this country is, not doing very well with all that. So are we leveraging what they've learned, and how have we figured out how they jumped the gun? And not we, the campus necessarily, but yeah, I guess, how do you do that, and how do you miss that boat? And are we figuring out how to make sure we the institute learns that?
I think this is a fantastic point. I think the answer is that we don't, we're not doing a lot of active benchmarking against other schools. Just to kind of get that out of the way. I mean, like Steve said, we could compare ourselves to Harvard, my alma mater. And, Harvard has invested more money in the physical infrastructure. They have set up a green campus sort of initiative. But again, the degree to which they're sort of setting targets and actually measuring against them in ways that they know that they can achieve what they want to achieve, the degree to which they're actually engaging students and the whole community in the process, opposed to doing it more top-down, and I think these are some of our strengths, but there's a lot more that we do need to do in terms of learning from others and benchmarking. This is one of the things I think is a really, really good role for student projects, to look at any one issue, really analyze it from how are other people approaching it, how's MIT approaching it, and what should we be doing differently. I hope we get to see a lot more of that as we really start to mobilize on this.
To India, I had noticed that many places that they are recycling newspapers, destroyed, any kind of paper, it's actually brought back in stores. So let's say the poor community are collecting papers, glass bottles, and whatnot, and they have a store to actually, you know, sell it at, and they're getting money for it, no matter how small it is. Maybe we can do in the future something like departments who contribute or recycle certain amounts, we can give them like keychains in the department or something like that, to just to encourage, you know. I mean, not necessarily in the U.S. we're going to get money for newspapers, you know, but that's what they do. That's what I've seen, you know, back in India.
A fundamental question, which I think we'll ask all of you to help us understand, is what incentives do we need as individuals, as departments, and schools to act in the ways that we think are beneficial? You know, individual departments aren't paying their energy bills at this point. So what, in the absence of that, what can we do? What's going to make people move? And we've seen just competition amongst peers is enough to make people move in certain directions. And so help us understand. We brought up, you know, talk about benchmarking. Somebody asked, what is Harvard doing to drive progress in getting people to close their fume hoods? And we learned that they offer cheese and cracker parties. We thought, great, that's perfect. We'll do that here. And then we were told, no way. That's such a Harvard thing to do. We don't want cheese and cracker parties as incentives. So tell me what it is then, if it's not cheese and crackers. Well, I bet a lot of you would like cheese and crackers.
Just to follow up on the getting the money back, there are some towns that do give people coupons for the recycling, and then you can use them at different stores. So there is some basis for, even in the U.S., locally having compensation for the recycling. So there might be something in the, you know, rather than cheese and cracker, you earn points for XYZ.
Yep. Terrific.
See this conversation sloughing over from energy into recycling sustainability. And it seemed to me for a long time, specifically since I read W.O.'s demo, that the metric we should be using is zero emissions. Alright? And I'm wondering if MIT has done a complete throughput analysis of all of the resources that they use and release, and has some kind of commitment to becoming a zero emissions institution, which is actually where we should be going.
I think it's in John Fernandez's group in DUSP. There's a project that started to do a material flow analysis for the entire campus. So what's coming in, what's going out, and really get a sense of kind of the whole big picture. As far as a commitment to being zero emissions, this is something that we haven't made as an institution yet. Is any sort of, you know, commitment to, you know, zero emissions or any other, you know, whatever other target. Right now, what we're doing is we're sort of saying, well, you know, we're trying to engage the community in saying, well, what can we accomplish here? What is possible? What do we know that we can do, you know, with the kind of measurement analysis that we've been talking about? Should we be making a stronger commitment? You know, I think that's an open question.
And what's a meaningful commitment? I mean, we've discussed it to some degree. You know, the city of Cambridge set citywide limits of reducing 10% below 1990 by 2010. Is that meaningful in driving action at the program level, project level? We're not sure. There's some skepticism of that, but there are different schools of thought. But I think understanding what it is that would motivate would motivate us as an organization would be important.
I can offer you a data point about 10, 12 years ago. I was part of a conversation between EHS people and IT people. And EHS people that we were talking to, really, the people who were most engaged were those who had taken that initiative based upon zero defect, statistical quality control, CQM, and what was then called environmental UN, and that goal of zero is an almost impossible goal.
But it's on
the
horizon.
But it really, really, really motivates you to do such a difficult problem, and it might be a difficult problem.
Exactly right.
Anybody in the front row here want to add anything? Okay. Yost.
a question? Yes.
So this Reading MIT Behavioral Change Campaign is a fantastic initiative. It's a good start, but it seems to me that the energy is not enough. What about maintenance, proper bike paths, greenways, roof gardens, aesthetics in our near neighborhood and on campus? Where's, to step back from that, where's the integrated campus master plan? What's your bold vision for that? What is MIT in 2020 going to be like? Because it seems to me we need a campus to be in 2020 what we'd like our cities, our countries, our society to be like in 2050 or earlier. Where's the big overarching vision here?
Well, I think we'd like to see all of that.
Yeah.
Where is it stated? Well, I think that's a good question. But I think our focus now, particularly focusing narrowly on energy with this outreach effort, is to focus on the things that we know we can act on now and that we feel can be joined by the broader community and really take advantage of what the now term offers. Because you asked that question, I had to use that term. But it's really what can we do right now while not waiting for any grander master plan.
That's nice, but not enough.
Yeah.
All right, help us.
I would encourage you. If a vision for MIT 2020 is what it's going to take to galvanize the campus, and if that's something that you really believe, then you should organize an effort to develop a vision for the MIT campus of 2020. And enroll us as the task force members in doing it. Like Steve said, the right now I think the vision is total engagement of the campus. Everyone on campus knows what the Greening MIT logo is, what it means. Everyone knows that they have something to contribute. Everyone knows that they have an idea who they can communicate it to so that we can get everybody into that conversation and produce the vision and produce the action. That's our goal right now. I think that will start to build the sort of engagement infrastructure and the human energy that it'll take to do things like articulate a really compelling, powerful vision for 2020 that will move the campus forward. But that's kind of what we're trying to do here, is start this conversation. I'm wondering if we should continue the conversation over refreshments. There's some free food outside that I'm sure we're all eager to get to.
Did Tim get there first, though?
Tim might have gotten there first. He's a big guy. He might have eaten it all. But we're all going to be out there. All of us will be here answering questions. Thank you so much for coming.
Well done. Thank you all.